Your Steve Jones Show podcast will start shortly. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Brewers Outlet, your beverage supermarket on Reagan Street in Sunbury. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket, imports, domestics, microbrews, the best selection of beer anywhere. It is the 4th of July weekend, and you need to be fully stocked for the 4th of July. Yeah, make sure you have plenty of water. Need to hydrate. Wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. Need to hydrate water. Roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day. 6 great flavors of slushies. And the pickle bar, led by the barrels and the dills. Indeed, second to none. All of Brewers Outlet. Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Tim Brando on the show today. We've got Dick Girardi on the show today. Greg Brown, the voice of the Pirates, on the show today. We'll save it. You know, we'll get Ed DeChellis on next week. But that's what we have going on in today's show. A lot going on. Let's start with, there are several items that we need to obviously get to because of what has happened in the landscape. You know Kevin Warren was in London when this happened, right? Just thought I'd point that out. But the when the Big Ten couldn't get Notre Dame, I knew they needed a 12th team because that was the only way at that point to get a conference championship game, which, my opinion, I felt the Big Ten needed. Okay. And they tried to get Notre Dame in 99, couldn't do it. So now you're looking around, and you have to look at the landscape as to where it stood in 2011. In the landscape where you stood in 2011, you're like, okay, I wasn't that pumped up that they got Nebraska, but I understood it, made sense, fit out west, and okay. My thought was, good. Getting Nebraska in, good. Colorado, they left, and they went to the Pac-12. Missouri and Texas A&M went to the SEC. Okay. And that round came and went, and I thought, okay, the Big Ten came out of it, good. All right, they got Nebraska. It's not Notre Dame, but they got Nebraska. Okay. Yeah. Not awesome and incredible, but good. And then the Rutgers-Maryland thing came up. The plus to me on Maryland and Rutgers was that they were close, they were drivable. And I remember when the Big Ten tournament was in Washington, I had a good laugh out of this. It was in Washington, and my brother and some of the who were Big Ten announcers were some of the greatest guys going. There's no getting around it. It's awesome. But a couple of them privately said, oh, man, you know, it's the first time I've never driven to a Big Ten tournament. You know, what are we doing here? Blah, blah, blah. We ought to be back. And I looked at them, and I said, yeah, but this, you got to remember, this is the first time I've ever driven to a Big Ten tournament. They went, oh. I said, I'm always the one flying. They went, oh, yeah. Okay. And then when the Big Ten tournament was at Madison Square Garden, it was a huge hit. They had to make so many adjustments to the schedule to make it happen because it was a week earlier.
Yeah.
You know, so it did cause a little bit of consternation. But in terms of being in the Garden, it was a huge hit. I mean, I was there for 4 days of it because Penn State made the semifinals. And the attendance was great. New York just loved it. It was fabulous. But Maryland and Rutgers coming in, I was like, all right. I know the financial reasons, but all right. Oh, would it make life a little easier for me? Yeah, sure. I mean, I drive to Rutgers. I drive to Maryland. You know, I can go down and see my son, my daughter in Virginia, and then pop over like I did this year. Yeah. So, I mean, on a personal basis, yeah. But, and I understood the 16 million homes. I understood that. And then yesterday happened. And my reaction to Nebraska was, okay, good. You know, I get it. You know what? It's a good fit. It'll work. All right. Maryland, Rutgers, I was like, oh, really? Okay. All right. This one, I was excited about. I thought, this is great. I've always been someone, as you know in the show, that if you want to do something and you want to make a move, you go big. And you've heard me say that on the show how many times in the 10 and a half years I've done the show. If you're going to do something, go big. Don't just do it to do it. And that's why last year when Texas and Oklahoma went to the SEC, I said the one thing you cannot do is panic. And remember the names that were brought up, Iowa State, Kansas. I'm like, I'm sitting there like going, Iowa State and Kansas. So Iowa State adds nothing, zero. You're just adding teams to add teams. And, of course, we've had Tony Knopp on the show several times. As you know, we usually have Tony on the show 4 or 5 times a year. Tony is very connected to the people at USC. He works literally down the street from me. He's very connected with the people at USC, very. And he has said on this show repeatedly, so that's why we use him as the source. And again, it's important to tell you the source. Instead of saying, I've got sources, like it's some big secret. No. Tony's the one that told you, the audience, told me as the host. They are very dissatisfied with the Pac-12 to the point where, you know what? They could even go independent. I mean, Tony said that on the show. They could even go independent. Though, wow. And that's why last year on the show I said, hey, look, if you're going to go big for somebody, I don't know. Go for Notre Dame. Go for USC. Go big. I said, don't go small. Yeah, you know, that's why Iowa State, Kansas. Iowa State in Kansas. Iowa State's like Pitt. And I say again, with all due respect, there's nothing to do with who it is. Once you get a state, you're done. Okay? You now have that territory. It's yours. So Iowa doesn't give you the state of Iowa. You already got Iowa. Pitt doesn't give you Pennsylvania. I already got Penn State. Now, Penn State gave the Big Ten the New York market to begin with. And they probably gave them the D.C. Baltimore market as well. Penn State did that. And the Big Ten people will tell you that. It's right. But technically, from a territorial point of view, you can't have the Big Ten network be on the prime tier unless you actually have a school in the state in it. So Rutgers, New Jersey, Maryland for D.C. and Maryland. Okay. Now you got this. This was the home run. And I think it is phenomenal. If you're going to sit there and you're going to make a move of impact. When it comes to Oregon and Washington, who are two excellent brands, Seattle's a huge market, Portland's a big market, But if you expand, and anybody in business will tell you this, any expansion you do must make your pie bigger. And I remember when Penn State got into the Big Ten, it was announced in December 22nd of 89 and then officially approved June 4th in 90. I was talking to somebody in the Big Ten, and they said, well, the key is when you expand, whomever you bring in has to have an impact financially that brings in more money for the conference, because you'll now be slicing up the pie instead of 10 ways, 11. So the pie has to be bigger so everybody's getting a bigger slice. That's how he explained it to me. Never forgot that analogy. When Nebraska came in, it brought with it the Big Ten championship game, $25 million. It made the pie bigger, so yes, it was worth it. Rutgers and Maryland, 16 million households in the corridor between New York and D.C. And that does bring in more money. Even though Penn State already gave them the markets, it officially gave you the territory of the footprint. We all know what UCLA and USC do. We know it. They not only Los Angeles, but they give you California. When it comes to Oregon and Washington or anyone else, because now we're going to get into the silly season, and the silly season is everybody's going to throw names up against the wall. Got to get Miami, got to get Florida State, got to get Clemson, North Carolina, got to get Oregon, Washington. What about Arizona State? What about Colorado? Colorado, you know, Denver, 12th largest market in the country. Okay? So what do? It has to be a move that makes the pie, financial pie, bigger. You just can't bring in, let's go to 20 and bring in four more, and everybody's getting smaller slices of pie than they were going to get before. You can't do that. It's got to make a move that makes the financial resources greater so everybody's getting more money than before because you made the move. And that's why I think at 16, that's where the Big Ten's going to be. I don't think they're going to 20 right now. Now, maybe within 5 years, maybe they will go to 20, but I think they're going to go at 16. And the timing is perfect because look at the SEC. They negotiated their TV deal and then added Texas and Oklahoma. They'd like a renegotiate to get a little bit more because of that impact. The Big Ten doesn't have to do that. Jack Ham and I were just talking about this. And I said, Jack, they don't have to do that with this. Their contract is not signed yet. The new contract is going to include USC and UCLA beginning on August 2nd, 2024. I said, so now it's going to be built in. That's why this contract, it may extend into August, the negotiations, because it has now got greater value than it did 2 days ago. And that's what makes this even better. Sports Business Journal is reporting that Apple, which had backed out of the negotiations on streaming, now, according to Sports Business Journal, wants back in to make a bid because of this. That's the kind of power that's now at the table. Bringing in extra mouths to feed, they have to bring with them extra dollars. And I think this move with these two schools, and UCLA has been hemorrhaging money, just so you know, UCLA has been hemorrhaging money. They needed to do this. If you're Mike Bone, the athletic director at USC, you're saying Rutgers is getting 2.5 times the TV money USC is? Because that's what it was going to come down to. Rutgers is? No. So can you blame them for them wanting to come here? And you can't blame the Big Ten for saying yes. This was not just a move. It was a dynamic move. If you're asking about Oregon and Phil Knight, fair. But I will remind everyone, Oklahoma State has T. Boone Pickens. Where's Oklahoma State? They are not in the SEC, are they? They did not go with Oklahoma. So even though Oregon has Phil Knight, and Oregon has done a really good job with its programs, and they have great facilities, just because they have Phil Knight does not is not an automatic that you should say, hey, come on and join the party. Because guess what? Oklahoma State has T. Boone Pickens. And guess what? They're in the Big 12. They did not get an invite. The NBC deal with Notre Dame runs through 2025. Notre Dame has some serious items to think about. Notre Dame does not have grant of rights problems with football. None. Zero. Their grant of rights all deal with all the other stuff in the ACC, in particular in basketball. Financially, they've got enough, I think, juice to get out of it if they needed to. If you are a Clemson, North Carolina, Miami, Florida State, Oregon, Washington, you're looking around today and saying, what can we do? But for the Big Ten, and I think even for the SEC, I think they are now sitting there saying, we got 16 of the best brands in America in our conference. In particular, we've got Penn State, Ohio State, Michigan, USC, UCLA. I mean, you've got brand power. And same can be said for the SEC, Alabama, Georgia, Texas A&M, Texas, Oklahoma, LSU, Auburn. Do you need to do more? Because it comes down to a question of management and also money. Because you have to divide it. The more people you bring in, the more you have to divide up. You might have enough now because you hit a home run yesterday, a grand slam. Back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Party time, game time, or just fun time. Doesn't matter what time it is, because it's Brewers Outlet time. The Beverage Supermarket has the area's largest beer selection. Imports, microbrews, ciders, and domestics. Pick from over 100 ice-cold 12-packs and dozens of 24-ounce singles. Soda, snacks, hot sauces, fresh roasted peanuts. Make it one-stop party shopping, and don't forget the pickle bar. So whatever you're celebrating or just doing it up, Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street, Sunbury, wants to see you. And thank you for your years of patronage.
Here's another point to make. I've been saying with the TV contract, maybe it's important to keep ESPN in there somewhere because you don't want to be on ignore, because they do have a tendency to do that. But now that you've got Penn State, Ohio State, Michigan, Michigan State, Wisconsin, Iowa, USC, UCLA, do you need ESPN? Can you get enough from streaming NBC, CBS, and Fox? And BTN? It's something to think about. It's one thing about Fox, but they give ESPN competition.
Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the Beverage Supermarket. And it is 4th of July weekend, so stock up. It's going to be hot. It's going to be nice. You want cold beverages. Imports, domestics, microbrews, best selection of beer anywhere. Wine coolers, water, soft drink, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and out every day. Six great flavors of slushies. And the pickle bar led by the barrels and the dills, indeed second to none. All at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Do we have Tim yet? Just asking here if we do or not. Max, do we have Tim yet? Tim Brando?
Yeah, we do.
Okay. It's not up on the screen, so I apologize. I'll tell you right now, I see the videos of that left-handed swing. Being a lefty myself, it's smooth. Tim, welcome to the show. It's so great to have you.
Okay, I can hear you now. I could barely hear you a moment ago.
There you go.
Did you say something about my left-handed swing?
Yeah, it looks smooth on tape. And I, as a fellow lefty, I'm loving it. It looks great.
Well, you know, I actually get, I didn't know this, but I now do. It's like I get requests for them now. So much to the chagrin of some people who probably get really tired of seeing my golf videos, I actually do them. I try to be instructional now for all the double-digit handicappers out there. You know, so I am a very proud 9 handicap. So my running joke is get Timmy B's tips from the tee because unlike David Ledbetter, he's been where you've been.
Yeah, that's why I'll see something on TV once in a while. They're in some jungle somewhere, and I'll say, you know what? I know how he feels. So, Tim, perfect guy to talk to. Always the best in perspective. Obviously, yesterday was dynamic and seismic. How did you view the move of USC, UCLA now being a part of the Big Ten world starting in 2 years?
Well, let me begin. Have you seen my most recent tweet? I know you're on the air, so you probably have.
Have not seen your most recent tweet,
okay.
No.
All right. Well, when you get off the air with me here, even in a commercial break, it only lasts 2 minutes, you can get a pretty good idea of how I feel about what is transpiring. Everybody... of course, you know, on social media, people just want to bitch and be upset and mad and angry. So yeah. The doomsayers are like, oh, I'm not going to be watching. You know, they were ruining college football. It's not what it was. You know, especially those that are my age and older, you know, the baby boomers. And I'm like, yeah, right. Sounds good right now. Yeah. But when toe meets leather, I guarantee you, you're going to be watching. And now, you know, the outlook is going to be even greater for better games, and more games in the postseason with magnificent rivalries only enhanced within the top conferences with the blue blood programs. I think what USC and UCLA did was, yes, seismic, but not unexpected. I mean, I'm not shocked, and I don't think anybody that follows college football on a regular basis or is as passionate about it as I've always been is surprised at all. We saw this coming. A year ago at this time, we were all commenting on how the Big 12 was done after Texas and Oklahoma left, and not only are they not done, I think they're only going to continue to grow and improve and probably entrench themselves as the third top conference in terms of television revenue. Granted, it won't be like the Big 2. The Big 2 are without question the Big 10 and the SEC, and they're not done yet, not by a long shot. And I would expect that over the next 2 to 4 weeks, you're going to see even more mega announcements that will set people on their collective ears going, oh, my God, we never thought that this would happen. And so I think that for both Southern Cal and for UCLA, they just made themselves even more relevant, and they certainly stabilized their long-term futures economically. And that's the big thing now. And that's what all the other teams that are not with the Big Ten or the SEC are looking to do. Phone lines are being burned up right now in Clemson, South Carolina, and in South Bend, Indiana. And those are the next two most valuable teams to go and get if you're the Big Ten. And there are options out there, maybe even leverage, if you will, for those two schools. With the SEC as well as the Big Ten, which means that the need is such that there probably will be some negotiating that goes on on both ends to see where either one of them lands. But I suspect, based on the people I have spoken to, that it is a done deal that Notre Dame is going to be headed to a conference. And I know there are a lot of Irish blue bloods out there that can't believe it, but it's going to happen. And the reason is economics, pure economics. You can have your cake and eat it too if you're Notre Dame. Their television deal with NBC is good, but it's not great. And after it runs out in 24, there's a very good chance, who knows, that they could still have their home games on NBC and potentially stay in the Big Ten, and all their away games would be on Fox. I mean, there's all kinds of possibilities, Steve. Nothing is off the table.
Right.
Everything is on the table.
It is on the table because
everything is on the table. But those are the two programs you start with. Now, the ones that make the most sense that are left over in the Pac-12, that would be seeking an address change, and likely the Big Ten would be the landing spot, are Oregon and Washington in that order.
Right.
Those are the two that make the most sense in what's left of the Pac-12. So George Kliavkov is, I'm sure, working his phone. It's probably connected to his earlobe right now and hasn't been off of it all day. But the next conference that's really in peril is the ACC. They have the worst TV deal. Yes, they have a grant of rights, but schools can pay off those grants of rights knowing that they're going to get a healthy check, whether they're going to the SEC or the Big Ten. And if they want to take them to court over the grant of rights, who's to say that they can actually enforce that? The deal that they currently have lasts until 2036, and each school in the ACC is netting a little bit over $12 million annually. Can I compare that to the other leagues, including the Big 12? Okay? Mm-hmm. They're not even in the same stratosphere. So imagine being as proud a program as Clemson is and looking around and going, okay, we got a problem here. Okay?
Yep.
And the situation for them in the SEC could be political, because those folks in Columbia, South Carolina might not want them in the league. Okay?
Right.
So the Big Ten may make a hell of a lot more sense, not only financially, but politically for them. I mean, it's going to be an incredible next, 2 to 4 weeks. And then but I will tell you, I think a lot of this is going to clear itself up by the time we get the season started. So between now and toe meeting leather, we may have a much better understanding of who's landing where. That means things are moving fast. This is going to make the Texas OU decision look like romper room. Okay, we've got an avalanche on our hands, and I don't think it ends here at all.
Well, in fact, to amplify what Tim's talking about, UCLA, by the way, they lost the Under Armour deal and so forth. They need money, so they've been hemorrhaging cash. If you're Mike Bone at USC, 2 months ago you're sitting there, and if Tim and I were sitting with him, he'd be saying, you're telling me in the new TV deal, Rutgers is going to get 2.5 times what USC's getting?
We need
to do something about that. And guess what? He did.
Yes, absolutely. And the same question's being asked at Clemson. And they're saying, Vanderbilt gets how much, and we get how much?
Yeah, exactly.
Wait, I mean, it's if you're doing your job as an athletic director, you've got to be thinking about your institution and its long-term financial viability. That's the job that they took, and that's what they're doing. And trust me when I tell you, I mentioned Clemson. Miami has Clemson's former athletic director, Dan Radakovich. Hess, who took over for Radakovich, was his right-hand man. I guarantee you Miami's not going to stand pat. And they're going to land somewhere, and so is North Carolina in all likelihood. You know, that's a team that, trust me when I tell you, is a proud program with a huge alumni base, with a lot of revenue. And even with the Duke rivalry and the original charter members of the ACC, and listen, I've got a long-standing ACC relationship, as you know. I did their college basketball dating all the way back to 1983 before I went to ESPN. And I did, until Raycom Sports went away, I was doing the Duke-Carolina game annually for them until 2019, when Raycom went away and they created this thing called the ACC Network. And you know, you talk about bad moves. Okay, this is where presidents need to stay the hell out of athletics. Sometimes, let me just tell you this quick story. When the SEC got its own network, apparently some of these presidents were really upset that they had a network and the ACC didn't. You know, sort of that border rivalry between college presidents. Mm-hmm. They forced outgoing Commissioner John Swofford to get them a cable network. So when his TV rights deal came up, that became a real sticking point. Well, ESPN didn't want to do it because cable cord cutting was going on, Steve, as you know.
Yeah.
But they were relentless. These presidents are like telling Swofford, "You got to do it. You got to do it." And this is going to be his legacy as he's leaving. Well, he left Jim Phillips, the former Northwestern athletic director, the new commissioner of the ACC. He left Jim a terrible TV deal.
Yeah,
that's worth very little money, all because the presidents of the institutions in the ACC, by God, we've got to have a cable network because the SEC does. Now think about that. Okay, this is why you hire people that are in the sports business to handle your sports business when you're the president of the university.
Exactly, because why does Thompson Bowling Arena have 1,000 more seats than Kentucky? Because we have to have 1,000 more seats in Kentucky. I mean, those are the kind of decisions that are made where you sit back and go, what? You made a great point on one of your videos about Brett Yormack. You know, everybody talks about out-of-the-box hires. Yeah. No. You need business hires. The Big 12 was given up for lost a year ago at this time.
Yeah.
What kind of position is he in, are they in now, especially with a guy with his kind of business sense from Roc Nation?
Well, in many ways, because Bob Bowlesby did a hell of a job. You know,
people can
be critical of Bob all they want. And, you know,
I agree with you, Tim.
He lost a lot of friends when he took on the big kahuna that is ESPN and sent them a cease and desist letter about tampering with what was left of the Big 12. You know, there was this word out that maybe ESPN was trying to coerce some schools to join the American Conference. And, you know, I'm not going to get into the debate whether there was truth to that or not, but... You know, Bob got a lot of flack for that, but he went public with it. You know, he sent it out. Media people got a hold of it. And the truth is, though, when you lose Oklahoma and Texas, two of the heaviest brands that there are in college football, big-time blue bloods with history and tradition, you got to do a lot of groundwork to make sure that your league remains intact. Well, he had two things working. A really good grant of rights situation that put Oklahoma and Texas in a position where they were going to have to stay probably until the final year of the TV contract. Because if they tried to get out with 3 years left, as they did, $80 million is a lot, even for Texas and Oklahoma.
Mm-hmm.
So he had that on his side, and it gave him an opportunity to look at the landscape out there and say, okay, who can I get? Well, you know what? That American Conference has done a hell of a job. I'm going to go get Cincinnati. I'm going to get UCF. That's the Orlando market. I'm going to get Houston, which is, you know, got a great medical school and a great enrollment. And, okay, they're not Texas, but you know what? They're Houston. We hold on to the state of Texas. And then you add to that BYU, which even though people maybe in Illinois don't understand this, has a not just national brand, but an international brand. BYU games are a big deal and have been for quite some time. To get BYU to come in, from a TV standpoint, gave them, along with those other schools in major metropolitan areas that have had recent success, UCF and Cincinnati notably, he kept his league in a pretty good position. With the understanding that Oklahoma State and TCU now move to the upper tier along with Baylor. Baylor is in great shape with Dave Aranda. And now, with what's happened, Steve, he can go into Utah, Colorado, maybe clip those Arizona schools, Arizona and Arizona State, right out from underneath Kliavkoff in the Pac-12. I mean, right out from underneath.
Yep.
And, you know, he's worked at NASCAR. He's worked in the NBA. He worked in the entertainment business with Jay-Z before taking this job. He's dealt with media moguls, both digital and over-the-air network television. So that's who you need now. You know, coming up through the ranks as an athletic director, becoming a deputy commissioner, or maybe working in the enforcement and infractions area at the NCAA, like guys like Jim Phillips and especially Greg Sankey came up through that, that's really not any longer the conventional way of looking for guys to be commissioners, because you've got to be dealing with TV rights about every 5 or 6 years. All these deals have to be short-term rather than long-term because the economics are constantly changing. So, you know, Pac-12 hired Klyavkov from MGM, so the gaming community is where he came from. And, look, I like George, but he's got a lot of work to do now, okay, to hold on to whatever's left of his conference. But I'd say Yomar comes in with a pretty good situation in large measure because Bob Bowlsby, you know, didn't stop working, even though he was upset with the way things had gone. You know, I mean, that he's an unsung hero, I think, here. Because the Big 12, it's not going to be in the same financial position that either the SEC or the Big Ten are in, but they are clearly going to be the head of the class of what's left of the Power Five.
Excellent point. Love talking to you. Great perspective, as always. Better talking to you in person. All these contracts mean to me is I get to see you more. I like that.
Well, that, Tim, you know, I'm not gonna lie. At my age, at this, you know, I'm more grateful to be doing what I'm doing than ever, Steve. I've still got a lot of tread left on my tires, and I, for one, am happy to be alive when we're finally seeing so much of what I have been saying for 20 years needed to happen is finally happening.
True.
In the end, I know some local fans are, you know, hey, we're losing our territorial, our regional rival. I'm like, you know, that they're going to have to, you know, they're paying players. Listen, all this TV money is going to allow for revenue share opportunities once we can get Congress in a position to help those in charge of college football. And I think once the midterm elections are done, Steve, that's what's going to happen. If one party takes control of the House and Senate, then I think they can get some help in terms of regulating name, image, and likeness with the transfer portal so that everyone gets its fair share and the states don't have competitive advantages over other states. So I think college football in the next 10 years is going to see its greatest period of growth. I do.
And I agree with you. Absolutely. And you have been talking about this for 20 years. Tim, thank you so much. Appreciate you as always, my friend.
You take care, buddy. All the best.
Tim Brando, one of the best in the business. Dick Girardi in the next half hour. TV viewership. It's amazing what brands mean. Okay? Last year, if you add up all the viewers for Ohio State, 9 conference games for Ohio State, they brought in 50 million viewers. 9 conference games for Michigan, they brought in 50 million. Now remember, that last game between the two of them brings in 13 million each. Okay? So that's 13 million of that 50. So it's right around. Penn State brings in 39 million. Okay, we talked about like the ability to, you know, Penn State got them the New York, Washington, D.C. market. You want to know what Rutgers brought in last year on TV viewership? 6 million viewers total in the 9 conference games. That's 700,000 a game. And, of course, the 3 highest-ranking ones for them were Michigan, Ohio State, Penn State. That's what brands mean. Okay? That's what brands mean. Those are the 3 biggest brands in the Big Ten. The numbers show it. Now you bring in USC. Oh, UCLA. All right. But that's what brands mean. When you look at total viewership, it's right there in front of you. You know, I've got chart after chart after chart. That's all you got to do is just take some time and add it up. It's what it means. Back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKLK.